Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here. Today, we're going to be getting into part two of Judaism in West Africa before the Transatlantic Slave Trade. I'm not sure if that's going to be the full title by the time I'm done with this series, but that's the working title. Now, before we get into that, make sure you guys hit that thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. If you are not subscribed, please do so. Make sure you click the notification bell and turn on all notifications. And most importantly, please share this video so as many people as possible can see it. All right, now today's video is brought to you by Undeniable. Full color evidence of black Israelites in the Bible. If you're tired of arguing with people about the evidence, just show them the images. You can grab that on barnesandnoble.com and amazon.com. It's available in paperback and Kindle formats. This video is also brought to you by Undeniable 2, historical evidence of black Israelites in the Bible. This right here consists of some of the best historical references at the time. And I'm not going to say that yet. But anyway, it consists of some of the best historical references at the time. So make sure you grab this if you want to point people to the historical evidence. This too is also available on Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com in paperback and Kindle. I believe it's available on Nook in Barnes & Noble. And lastly, the newest project, Kushites in Babylon. Did a black empire once rule Arabia? This is part of the Banned Black History Volume 1 series. I'm going to release each part as I go. And then at the end, they will all be put together in one big compilation book. So if you have not grabbed your copy yet, make sure you do so. This one is available on Amazon.com, Kindle, and paperback. It is not available at Barnes & Noble just yet. All right, so now, in part one, I gave you guys a real quick review of what we learned so far from all these years of study. I showed you guys maps and where everybody was going. I'm talking about those banned from Spain and Portugal, the Jews, the Black Portuguese, whatever you want to refer to them as. The Israelites were put down into West Africa and some of them fled to North Africa. So today we're going to be looking at this book published in 2011 by Cambridge University Press. It was written by Peter Mark and Jose da Silva Horta. The Forgotten Diaspora, Jewish Communities in West Africa and the Making of the Atlantic World. One more time, Jewish Communities in West Africa and the Making of the Atlantic World. Now, here's what's interesting about this. This book right here shuts down a lot of arguments because one of the writers of the book, let me see, I tried to pull him up, but I could only really find reliable information on Jose da Silva Horta. He is a professor at the University of Lisbon in Portugal. So he's not just some random guy. This is not a student paper. This is right here, a book written by, I believe both of these guys are professors, if I'm not mistaken. But again, he's a professor at Lisbon, Portugal, which is important because this is what we're talking about. In a lot of these conversations, Portugal comes up. The transatlantic slave trade, the Portuguese are involved. The Inquisition, the Portuguese are involved. Both of them involve Jewish communities or Israelite communities. So I'm going to read this introduction, then we're going to get into some of the pages, and we're going to verify some of this stuff. We're going to cross-reference it with other works. It says, this book traces the history of early 17th century Portuguese Sephardic traders who settled in two communities on Senegal's Petite Cote, or Cote, I believe. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. So 17th century would be the 1600s. And remember, the American date that's accepted by most countries because of the 1619 landing here in America, that's the date that America puts on the beginning of the transatlantic slave trade, 1619. So that would be the 1600s. This here covers the early 1600s. It says, there they lived as public Jews under the spiritual guidance of a rabbi sent by the newly established Portuguese Jewish community in Amsterdam, and were protected from agents of the Inquisition by local Muslim rulers. Interesting, this came up before when I talked about what was going on in Egypt, where the black population of Egypt has separated from the white population, and they went to the Muslims to form an alliance to kick out the Greek Melkites, or the white Greek Melkites. They were left over from the Greco-Roman Empire. And here we see mentioned again that they were protected from the Christian or the Catholic Inquisition by the Muslims. Something interesting is going on in history that we aren't often told. The Petite Cote communities included several Jews of mixed Portuguese African heritage, as well as African wives, offspring, and servants. So we see right there, they were mixing. We've seen this on in other sources too. We'll come back to this. The blade weapons trade was an important part of their commercial activities. These merchants participated marginally in the slave trade, but fully in the arms trade, illegally supplying West African markets with swords. This arms trade depended on artisans and merchants based in Morocco, Lisbon, and Northern Europe, and affected warfare in the Sahel and along the Upper Guinea coast. The study discovers previously unknown Jewish communities, and by doing so offers a reinterpretation of the dynamics and processes of identity construction throughout the Atlantic world. All right, so we're going to get into some of these pages and we're going to talk about it. Do me a favor, hit that thumbs up if you haven't done so already. So now, if you're new to this topic, there are a lot of people in denial about what actually happened in history. And today I'm going to show you some common sense stuff, in addition to what we're going to read here in this book published in 2011. Now, people in the beginning said we were lying. There was no proof. And now we're running across all sorts of evidence, even leading into modern history, 2011. So if this is not true, why is it that a man who's a professor in Lisbon, Portugal, would co-write a book about forgotten diaspora and unknown Jewish communities in West Africa? That's the first common sense question. Why would a professor in Lisbon, Portugal, where a lot of this is centered around, why would he write a book about a forgotten Jewish diaspora in West Africa and unknown Jewish communities in West Africa if there's no reason to believe that there's a connection between those brought in the slave trade from West Africa and the Israelites of the Bible? A lot of people have been in denial about this, saying we were lying. They try to say we were fabricating history. They try to debunk it. But what you don't see, and again, this is one of those common sense things, what you don't see is them trying to debunk things published by Cambridge. We do not see direct attacks on these universities who are publishing the information in the books that we're reading from. So if you don't see that, there's a reason you don't see them challenging the people publishing. They only challenge the people reading from those publishers, like myself, Benaiah Israel, and others. What the strategy is, if they attack your credibility, they want to attack the person and the person's credibility instead of the actual information. And you guys will see this pattern. It's a deceptive tactic to win an argument, because their argument isn't based on truth or fact. It's based on opinions and feelings. They don't want black people to be associated with the people in the Bible, so they have already made up their mind and they're going to oppose it no matter what it says. But if you don't see them coming at these universities and trying to get these universities to print retractions for mistakes that they've made, there's a reason for it. Because as I mentioned in part one, Cambridge University puts their reputation on the line every time they publish. And that's according to them on their website. All right. So The Forgotten Diaspora, Jewish Communities in West Africa and the Making of the Atlantic World by Peter Mark and Jose de Silva Horta. All right. So we're going to read the introduction right here. Here we go. Peter Mark, Wesleyan University in Connecticut. Jose de Silva Horta, University of Lisbon. All right, Cambridge University Press. So we see there are some credentials about around this. So if anybody's saying these sources are lying, these sources are fake, if they put out any videos saying any of that, do me a favor, send those videos directly to Cambridge University and let them know that somebody's out here messing with their reputation, calling them liars, calling them deceivers, or whatever else they do in these videos. If they cannot debunk this, then it is what it is. If they can debunk it, ask them why they haven't got the retraction from Cambridge. All right, so here we go. Let's get to the intro. Let's see, where's it at? All right, we're not going to read the acknowledgments. Y'all hit that thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. All right, here we go. So we're going to start with the intro. And as we read through this, I'm going to show you guys some maps. This is the free preview on Google. I have a link to the full book on Amazon. It will be in the comments section along with the rest of the links to everything I'm going to show you today. If you want to buy this book in full, click the link and go grab it on Amazon. Now I'm going to read somewhat slow, and I'm not going to take a ton of time with the cross references because I want to get through a good chunk of this. It says, this is a book about the history of Portuguese Jews in an overseas diaspora. In a sense, it is a chapter of the historical narrative of Portuguese discoveries and expansion, and of the rivalry with other European countries. It certainly is part of the long history of Sephardic attempts to survive and adjust to adverse conditions at a moment when they were compelled to seek a life of safety in lands distant from the Iberian Peninsula. Now, real quick, just so you know what the Iberian Peninsula is, this is the Iberian Peninsula right here. You have Spain, and then you're going to have Portugal. And then down here is going to be Morocco, Algeria. This is North Africa here. And then up here, this other purple part is France. Now, remember these locations. I'll come back to them. You have France, you have Spain, you have Portugal, and then you have Northern Africa right here. You're going to have the Canary Islands situated over this way. For those that need to see this on a full map, this is the Iberian Peninsula. This is Morocco. You're going to have Algeria here. These are the Canary Islands. I believe this is Cape Verde. Let me see. Make sure I'm not getting you guys these wrong. Yes, this is Cape Verde. And you have the Canary Islands right here, which is where I showed you before. And you guys can see some of this right here. All right. So this is talking about the Iberian Peninsula. All right. But it is as well a chapter of the history of West Africa. Together with both Jewish and Christian Portuguese, African societies opened coastal and riverine paths to an Atlantic world in construction since the 15th century or the 1400s. In doing so, they shared responsibility for the impact of their local and regional histories throughout a wider, even a global world. In many ways, African and Euro-African agency made possible the complex intercultural relationships that constitute the subject of this book. As historians, we seek answers to this apparently simple query. How was it possible for Portuguese to engage in trade and also to be Jews in an African setting? A long process of Portuguese expansion led up to the 17th century events that are the core of this work. The 17th century would be the 1600s, during the transatlantic slave trade. All right, give me a one if you follow so far, two if you're not following. I'll try to clarify in a minute if you're not following. The Portuguese quest for gold, slaves, and imagined Christian allies started in the early 15th century or 1400s under the political initiative of Prince Henry and the support of the recently established Avis dynasty. Anglo-Saxon historiography named Henry the Navigator, although he was rather an organizer of a number of these travels and not an adventurer like the men whom he motivated, with noble titles and rewards to bring him news and commodities from faraway lands. Indeed, by the 1420s, Portuguese ships began to win the south, extending their usual raids from the waters off of North Africa and the Canary Islands to the unknown coast of the Sahara. So in the 1400s, they started to win. They said North Africa, the war south, or the push south. So you're going to have North Africa, and it mentioned the Canary Islands. Again, right over here, this is Iberian Peninsula. You have France, you have Spain, you have Portugal, you have Morocco, Algeria, the Sahara, you have the Canary Islands here. So in the 1400s, Portugal is already pushing southward further into Africa. So roughly 200 years before the American start of the transatlantic slave trade, 1420, America puts it at 1619 for the transatlantic slave trade. So 200 years. It says a decade after passing the physiological barrier of Cape Bahadur in 1434, they arrived at the Greenland of the blacks, as the land near the Senegal River was portrayed at the time. All right, so here's Senegal, and the Senegal River is going to be in Senegal. So by, what did it say, 1434? So by 1334, they were in Senegal, which is right here. Now, if you remember, I showed you they were already all along here in the previous video. They were already in North Africa in the previous video. I showed you that. This is just kind of giving you a timeline and showing you more places where they were. By 1448, the Portuguese were forced by African resistance and refusal to trade in a warlike context to abandon their initial policy of capture and plunder in favor of a diplomatic and peaceful approach. From then on, trade became the common ground between Africans and Europeans, and a shared history began. So understand what is going on here. The Portuguese are already pushing into Africa 200 years before the transatlantic slave trade. That's important because remember, the Jews that are expelled from Portugal are going to be sent into Africa, but we know the Portuguese had been there for over 200 years. Now, if you go back and watch the previous video, I pointed out that the Portuguese had named the area Judah because they believed that the tribes of Israel were there. Now, you can see that on this map here. Judah, or the kingdom of Judah, Witta, the slave coast. So the Portuguese already knew who was here. This is Sao Tome and Principe. Once again, the Portuguese have been pushing down into West Africa for about 200 years before the official start of the transatlantic slave trade in America. And I keep stressing the America part for a reason. All right. So let's keep going. The exploration of the West African coast and its major archipelago, the Cape Verde Islands, was completed in the 1460s. So let's look at the Cape Verde Islands one more time. So they had already pushed down to here by 1460. And then we looked at Senegal one more time right here. So the Cape Verde Islands here, Senegal's here. And around here is where you're going to find the slave coast, Kingdom of Judah. But Sao Tome is right here. So these maps are super important because I'm going to have a pop quiz question for you guys in a minute. All right. During the reign of King John II, we've heard this before. Dr. Henry Abramson confirms this. Go back and watch the last video. Portuguese ships explored the coast of West Central Africa in search of an eastern passage to the Indian Ocean. Let me see. I just want to make sure this is right. So I did try to pull up a map of West Central Africa. Here we go. This might be a better one. All right. So West Central Africa is where the Portuguese were. Let me see. All right. There it goes. All right. So you're going to have all this area right here is considered West Central Africa. This is another one over here showing West Central Africa. So it's going to encompass all of the territory for the transatlantic slave trade. Most of the territory right here. Here's another one. West Central Africa. So the Portuguese were all in this area in the 1400s. This is important because people will say that they didn't intentionally kidnap Israelites, put them into the transatlantic slave trade and bring them over here. But we have proof that they were in the area, so they weren't confused about who they were grabbing. This is going to be important when I go back to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, also published by Cambridge University. And I point out what they say. Well, actually, I pointed out last time. I don't have to go back over it again, so it saves some time. They were more likely, the people practicing Judaism in these areas were more likely to be seized in wars and sold as slaves. Why was it that practicing Jews, Black Jews, were more likely to be seized and sold as slaves? Because the Portuguese had already been persecuting them because of the Inquisition. Well, let's keep going. Let's finish the intro, and then we're going to get into some more interesting stuff in this book. During the reign of King John II, Portuguese ships explored the coast of West Central Africa in search of the Eastern Passage to the Indian Ocean. In 1497 to 1499, Vasco da Gama's fleet established a maritime connection between Lisbon, that's Portugal, and India, giving birth to the Carreira da India, or India Run. And the first official travel was established to what would be Brazil by 1500. So 119 years before the transatlantic slave trade starts here in America. Pop quiz. If you know the official language of Brazil, type it in the chat. If you don't know, press 2. If you know, type it in the chat. And if you don't know, press 2. There, the process of colonization would wait a generation. But elsewhere in South America, the Indies of Castile would require slaves by the second decade, or the 1520 of the 16th century. So that's the 1500s, so the second decade. So by the 1520s, they're going to need slaves in South America. So the official language of Brazil is Portuguese. That's the answer to the question. The official language of Brazil is Portuguese. To support European settlements. Meanwhile, diplomatic relationships were developed with African polities along the Atlantic coast, and trading systems were organized to bring gold and slaves across the ocean. So they had already started arranging for this slavery. They had already started preparing for what they were about to do. This seems very clear to me. Several systems of trade developed between Portuguese and Africans. On the one hand, there was a system based on fortified trading stations such as Arguim in present-day Mauritania. Let me see. All right, here's a map of Mauritania. So let's keep going. Where was I at? All right, so mid-15th century, so that's the 1400s, or Jorge de Mina, Elmina, and Axum in the Gold Coast, late 15th and 16th centuries. So now, the Gold Coast in the late 15th, which is the 1400s, and early 16th, 1500s. Now, the Gold Coast, one more time, for those who don't remember, the Gold Coast is right next to the Slave Coast. So we know they were already here in the 14th and 15th centuries, and this is right next to the Kingdom of Judah. And we know at the end of the 1400s, they put Jews here, Sao Tome and Principe. And we know from Hannah Adams, right here in her book, The History of the Jews, from the destruction of Jerusalem to the present time, she says the Spanish and Portuguese Jews claimed their descent from the tribe of Judah and found these pretensions on a supposition which prevails among them that many of their ancestors removed or were sent into Spain at the time of the Babylonian captivity. And down here in the notes, she says it appears that the Jews have no accurate deduction of their descent or genealogy. They suppose that they are in general of the tribe of Judah and Benjamin, with some among them of the tribe of Levi. So we have, according to Hannah Adams, They claim to be Judah, Benjamin, and Levi, aka the Southern Kingdom, aka the Kingdom of Judah. They were put here by the Portuguese right here into West Africa. And according to Cambridge University, which I'll come back to shortly, or we read it before, they escaped from Sao Tome, ended up in Angola and all across the coast here. We read the other sources. Go back to video one. In the 1890 source, it says that this was named Judah by the Portuguese because they were considered to be the lost tribes of Israel, or some of the lost tribes of Israel. So all of this stuff is historically consistent if you're not lying about history. Here, the Portuguese crown attempted directly to control the Atlantic trade. In conjunction with African trading networks against other European rivals and non-authorized Portuguese private entrepreneurs, Estomé or Sao Tomé became a base for trading activities, a number of them private, in the Gulf of Guinea, in the politics of Congo, and in Dongo in West Central Africa. But there, from the late 16th century or late 1500s, in order to encourage the slave trade to the coast, the Portuguese crown chose to settle and to attempt a conquest of what was called the Kingdom of Angola. Why did the Portuguese attempt to settle and conquer the Kingdom of Angola? Well, if we jump over here to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, written by Ulysses S. Santa Maria, published in 1987 by Cambridge University, same university, we can read that here. But what about the south of this margin of Saharan contacts? In the reign of John II of Portugal, nearly 700 Jews were taken from their kin and deported to the island of Sao Tome on the west coast of Africa. This island is close to Nigeria, Cameroon, and Gabon. Escaping from Sao Tome, the Jews immigrated to the coast of Angola between 1484 and 1499. They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous black population. So we know that they're mixing with the black population. Remember, they're Portuguese Jews, right? Most people assume that these are, they look like what we see today as Jews, but that's not the case. We have read before in other studies that they're always described as either black, tawny, or Negro. And either way it goes, if they reproduce with these women, the children are still Jews or Israelites. It wouldn't change. Near the Congo in Gabon in 1776, black Jews called Bavumbu or Mavambo or Mayambo or Mavumbu lived on the coast of Luango by the river named Rio Muni, and it would seem that they adopted Christianity at the same time as maintaining their Judaism. We talked about that before. The conversos or the new Christians were Jews who were forced to convert to Catholicism by the Inquisition. Now I'm going to read down to here real quick because it's going to give a tie-in to what we're about to read in the other section. This is why I like this source. I told you guys, this is one of my favorite sources. By 1847, David Livingstone discovered a group of educated blacks living in the interior, some 200 miles from the coast of Luanda. These blacks were called the Jews of Angola. They were good merchants, learned easily, and had a knowledge of Portuguese law and history. They were often employed as clerks and writers. For Livingstone, there was no doubt but that these people were the descendants of those who had been deported from Portugal in the 15th century or 1400s. Other evidence supports this intuition. In Savage Africa, Winwood Reed writes of having met in Guinea blacks claiming to be Portuguese around 1864. Closer to our time, Dr. J. Kreppel noted that sometime after the First World War, that a large community of black Jews existed in the interior of Dahomey. These Jews had the five books of Moses written on parchment in Hebrew. And here is Guinea, the Guinea world map right here. All right, it's fully loaded. So Guinea, they met black Portuguese in Guinea, and then you have Angola. Let me pull up Angola map. Here we go. So it says they escaped Sao Tome. They settled in Portuguese Jewish colonies in Angola. And then if we come back over here, let's come back over here. Let me see where it says, but there, from the late 16th century or late 1500s, in order to encourage the slave trade on the coast, the Portuguese crown chose to settle and to attempt a conquest of what was called the Kingdom of Angola. So the Portuguese, who deported the Jews to Sao Tome, the Jews escaped to Angola, and here come the Portuguese right to Angola with more slavery. Give me a one if you're still following. Give me a two if you're lost and confused and have no idea how the Inquisition and the transatlantic slave trade are connected. It says the system of settlement and trade was quite different in the most important spaces of Euro-African commerce in Western Africa. Greater Senegambia, henceforth Senegambia, or in other words of contemporary Portuguese, Guinea of Cape Verde, this region also broadly coincides with the current usage Upper Guinea coast. From the Senegal River Basin southeast to present-day northwestern Sierra Leone on the coast, and from the Saharan fringe to the Atlantic forest, Greater Senegambia has been historically a transitional space. Within West Africa, this was the region that engaged early and most deeply in the Atlantic trade and established intense interaction with the Atlantic world. Long-distance mandate orders connected the Sahel and Savannah to Guinean routes and markets, where they met other African agents of local and riverine commerce. From the mid-15th century or 1400s onwards, this trade network connected with Luso-African merchants and European traders. There's a new word for us, Luso-African. Now we're going to jump down a bit. This is page 3. We're going to jump down to here and pick up. All right. The earliest commerce between Guinea and Cape Verde and the Atlantic world was centered in the Cape Verde Islands, located about 250 miles off the West African coast. So once again, Cape Verde is right here, located about 250 miles off of the coast. From the 1460s until the early 17th century, that's the 1600s, Santiago Island was the base for Portuguese activities in the rivers of Guinea. The Cape Verdean colonists, or Moradores, another new word, those mostly of Luso-African origin who had the status of residents were given the privilege of trading on the coast by the crown. To limit private activity and stimulate internal growth, the crown severely limited trade by the Cape Verdeans and all other Portuguese. One response was to become lancados, new word for us, i.e., to launch themselves on the mainland, beginning a new life in close association with African societies. Interesting, that's how they define a lancado. Those launched themselves onto the mainland, or lancado. Trading in forbidden merchandise, lancados, or tangomas, as they were also known, did not hesitate to conduct business with European rivals of the Portuguese crown. By the mid-1500s, both the French and English brought ships to the Guinea coast, challenging the theoretical Portuguese monopoly. By the 1580s, both were a regular presence, particularly in northern Senegambia. At the end of the century, they were joined by the Dutch, which is an important part of the study. So, they're going to be in Senegambia. All right, so Senegambia is a combination of Senegal, which is right here, and Gambia, which is this little sliver in here. So, it's a combination of two. Gambia and Senegal, you get Senegambia. All right, wrong one. All right, at the end of the century, they were joined by the Dutch, which is an important part of the story. The Portuguese crown was never able to impede their illegal activities. During the 16th and 17th centuries, so the 15 and 1600s, the crown either traded directly through its own representatives or much more frequently rented out trade to private traders, the Contradores, who held the so-called contract of Cape Verde. Unlike Arguim, Elmina, and Luanda, there were no fortified settlements in Guinea of Cape Verde until 1588. when Kashu was founded. Only by about 1600 did Kashu become a quasi-official settlement with a vicar or vicar and crown representatives. By that time, the trading station was already crucial to the Atlantic trade, and it surpassed Riviera Grande on Santiago Island from the middle of the 1610s onward. The first capital Moor was nominated in 1615, so 4 years before the official start of the transatlantic slave trade in America. Nevertheless, given its mixed identity population, and the tension between Portuguese officials and private groups and individual traders, Kashu did not achieve the same level of commercial security as did forts like James Island in the Gambia River. Furthermore, the captain was himself dependent, as were other crown delegates before him, on the Contradores, who in turn nominated factors and other officers. African rulers, for their part, were interested in the diversification of trading partners. Any protection they could give to the Lancados meant the latter could serve as intermediaries with European traders from other nations besides Portugal. So the Lancados have some amount of protection from the African rulers. Or I guess the African rulers are providing some protection for the Lancados. I'll say it that way. Now pay close attention. It says, under these conditions, the Lancados settled near the rivers and frequently married African women. Isn't that what we just read from Cambridge University? They must have settled in several Portuguese colonies and over the centuries mixed with the indigenous black population. So far, Cambridge is consistent. So if people are out here saying that this is not true, I mean, they should take it up with Cambridge and really get this retraction printed. Because in 1987, they published it saying it, and here they are again in 2011, staying consistent, publishing people saying the same thing. During the 16th century, the 1500s, Lancados, who did not return to Cape Verde or Portugal, and their Luso-African offspring, the Filhos de Terra, formed the core of the Luso-African communities. Interesting. So during the 1500s, you had Luso-African communities in West Africa. So now, the Petite Coast, this is page 5, Sephardic communities in Kashu and Rio Grande region. So this is Africa. This is the section they're talking about right here. And what do we see? Sephardic communities in Africa. One here, one here, one here. Let's talk about this little area right here. We see Kashu or Kasho. I'm not sure how you pronounce it. Right here. Basa, or you sometimes you see it spelled Basu with an E instead of an A every now and then. But right here and right here. And then this is another one right here. These are modern capitals, but you'll see these come up a lot. But right here, these three Sephardic communities. All right, so we're clear that there are Sephardic communities in Africa. Map of coastal Senegambia, locating the three Sephardic communities and main toponyms and rivers. One more time, right here. This is the Atlantic Ocean. This is going to be Africa, Senegambia, and you got those. So now the Luso-Africans. So you have the Lancados who got onto the land. They start mixing with the African women. And from what I'm understanding here, it calls them Luso-Africans. All right. So we got the term Luso-African. We got Lancados. We know that they were marrying into the black population, which is consistent with history. Scripture, the Bible, is consistent with what was happening in the Caucasus Mountains between the black tribe of Manasseh, the black Khazars, and the white Khazars. They would marry each other. We read before, I believe it was Hannah Adams that mentioned that you could stab a Jew in the face Or you could stab somebody in the face for accusing you of being a Jew if you lived back then because of the Inquisition. But we also know that the Sephardic Jews didn't mix with the German Jews. And we know that the Sephardic Jews are linked to the tribe of Manasseh, the some black tribe of Manasseh, also the black Jews in India. We know all these are linked to each other based on all the studies we've done. It says living in African villages or founding their own communities, these Luso-Africans also included the Grumetes, literally cabin boys. The Grumetes were African mariners who were indispensable as navigation guides, as translators, and as agents. So we're seeing the mixing of Jewish or Israelite communities with the local African population. There's no way around this. So if you have never heard the term Luso-Africans, I encourage you to study the Luso-Africans. Start to research this stuff so people can't lie to you any longer about what was going on. Also research the Lankados. Shout out to B'nai Israel. He's put out a lot of information on these subjects. It says the offspring of the Lankados identified as Portuguese and Christians and had a number of other ethnic markers. They were traders. They spoke Portuguese or Criollo. I wonder if that's has something to do with Creole, possibly. I don't know. It's a lot of interesting stuff comes here. I don't know what Criollo is. I'm not the linguistics guy. And they had a distinctive material culture. Material culture, for those of you who have taken an anthropology class, material culture refers to tools, the type of tools or devices they would use. Now, real quick, before we get too far, I want to go into the notes because the notes have something interesting in them. So in West Africa, they were speaking, what is this called? Criollo? Now, let me show you something real quick. I just want to pull this up. Omeka, .net. O-M-E-K-A. I just want to go down and here you have the Gullah language tidbits. I just want to read some quick facts about Gullah. You guys can look into Gullah before. I told you guys Gullah sound a lot like Hebrew to me. Now, I'm not the linguistics guy. Shout out to Pastor Kelly. He's more the linguistics guy than me. Way more. I'm not the linguistics guy. So if you have questions, go over to We Woke Now's YouTube channel. Hit up Pastor Kelly Richardson. And yeah, hit him up. I'm not the linguistics guy. I'm just going to read what it says. It says the language spoken by the Gullah Geechee people is Gullah. Gullah is a Creole language made up of English and several African languages. The primary African language that makes up Gullah is Kriya, spoken by the people of Sierra Leone. All right, so here's the Sierra Leone right here. Notice how close it is over here to Senegambia. And all these places the Portuguese were involved. But let's keep reading a couple more of these facts. Gullah is the only English-based Creole language used in the U.S. New Orleans Creole is French. Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas was raised as a Gullah speaker. I didn't know that. In 2017, Harvard University began to offer Gullah as a language class in the African Languages Program. I didn't know that either. In the 1930s and 40s, the linguist Lorenzo Dow Turner did a seminal study of the language based on field research in rural communities in coastal South Carolina and Georgia. Turner found that Gullah is strongly influenced by African languages in its phonology, or the way it sounds, the phonics, vocabulary, grammar, sentence structure, and semantics. Turner identified over 300 loanwords from various languages in Africa, in Gullah, and almost 4,000 African personal names, basket names used by the Gullah people. He also found Gullahs living in remote seaside settlements who could recite songs and story fragments and do simple counting in Mende, Vai, and Fulani languages of West Africa. Interesting. In 1949, Turner published his findings in Africanisms in the Gullah dialect. The fourth edition of this book was reprinted with a new introduction in 2002. Okay, so we know they speak, was it Criollo? And again, I said it sounds something like Creole, but let's go to the notes. It says, frequently, grumetes belonged to African ruling lineages and were given by their own relatives to be raised by the Portuguese, whom they then escorted in their maritime activities. The grumetes served as crucial brokers. They generally accepted the Christian religion and identified themselves with Luso-African society. Again, these are these Jews that were put down there and started mixing with the women, the Lankados, and their offspring were called the Luso-Africans. They would still be Israelites. There's no, well, these were only part Israelites, because we see in the Bible, if you go that route, you have to keep the same energy with Joseph and Asenath when Joseph had Ephraim and Manasseh with the Egyptian woman. They still considered them Israelites. So if these Jews have kids with these African women, and these Jews are calling themselves the Luso-Africans, they would still be Jews or Israelites by blood descent. So let me see. They identify with Luso-African society while maintaining the ability to switch their identity in different circumstances. I told you guys before, sometimes these people were switching identities to escape persecution and certain other things. Sometimes you encounter Jews pretending to be Moors and Moors pretending to be Jews in different cases. Sometimes you will encounter Jews who pretend to be Africans. Sometimes you encounter Portuguese who pretend to be Africans. You'll encounter this. They employed a lot of methods to escape persecution because they were in a desperate situation. And I'm going to show you why in a minute. It says the formation of a Portuguese-based Creole language in Guinea of Cape Verde may not predate the second half of the 17th century or 1600s. Creole was connected with the process of urban encapsulation of Luso-Africans. Wait, Creole? Isn't that what they speak? So wait, the Luso-African offspring of the Lankados are connected with Creole, and this is going on in West Africa. And then you get over here to the Americas and you find people speaking Creole still, which is connected with African. Well, let's see. We'll see. I'm not the linguistics guy. I could be wrong. Let me see. Creole was connected with the process of urban encapsulation of Luso-Africans, a kind of Portuguese, neither a pidgin nor a Creole, was spoken on the coast by Africans and Luso-Africans as a language of trade and religion, a status it shared, for example, with Mandinka. See P.E.H. Hare, the use, let me come down here, of African languages in an Afro-European context in Guinea. And here's a source for that. And then we'll read this last one. In 1601, in exchange for payment, a special authorization was given by Philip III to new Christians, or Jews who converted to Catholicism, to leave Portugal and settle overseas. In 1609, the 12 years truce began. It allowed new Christians to circulate and engage in maritime business with Northern Europe. So a 12 years truce. So if it starts in 1609, it's going to come to an end in 1621, 2 years after the transatlantic slave trade's official date in America. Let's see. See, Jose, this gives you the source right here. Judaismo Portuguese Lisbon Eratoria says the general pardon of 1605 granted for the crime of Judaism may also have offered an opportunity to leave the country without risk of arrest. Interesting. Judaism was a crime in 1605, 14 years before the official start of the transatlantic slave trade in America. All right, let's come back up. So they spoke Criollo. They had a distinctive material culture. And we'll look at this map, Greater Senegambia and Cabo Verde in West Africa. And this map is turned sideways, so it's hard to see, but I encourage you to look at this map when you go to the link. Here we go. This is page 8. How did Portuguese Jews fit into this environment? The history of their presence is part of the forced diaspora from Iberia. Once again, the Iberian Peninsula consists of Spain and Portugal. Now, let me ask you something. Since we're talking about forced migration, here's the pop quiz. If they were here and the Alhambra decree was issued to where they were forced to leave Spain. And as we know, Dr. Henry Abramson confirms that many of them left to Portugal. Now, after they got kicked out of Portugal, what are their options? Can they go back through Spain and return to France? They could. Could they go to North Africa? They did. But what would stop them from going to France? Because see, people will often say that, well, these couldn't have been black Jews. They couldn't have went into Africa. But what choice did they have? See, if you're familiar with history, once they got kicked out of Spain in the 1400s, they had no choice but to go to Portugal. And once they are kicked out of Portugal, they have no choice but to flee to Northern and Western Africa. Africa was literally their only choice. Why was that? If we come back over to here to 1394, this is before the Alhambra decree and they are kicked out of Spain. Because remember, one more time, I want you to see this map. You have France here, Spain here, Portugal here. So we come over here, King Charles VI of France orders all Jews expelled from the kingdom. So that's in 1394. So I'm going to read this right here. It's real short. It says, King Charles VI of France orders the expulsion of all Jews from his kingdom, the culmination of a series of anti-Semitic orders from the monarchs of France. The order outlived the monarchy and remains one of the major contributing factors to the tiny percentage of the French population that identifies as Jewish. As with most European nations, France had been home to Jews since antiquity. Also in the rest of Europe, the Jews of France faced frequent discrimination and persecution. French Jews had already suffered through burnings of their religious texts, I've mentioned this before, discriminatory taxes and other fiscal policies targeted at Jews, being scapegoated for the Black Plague, and multiple prior attempts to expel them from France. Various cities in France independently expelled their Jews throughout the 13th and 14th century. So the 1200s and 1300s was France expelling the Jews. Some of them were already in Spain. Some of them left into Spain. And then in the 14 and 1500s, you're going to see the Jews expelled into North and West Africa. And then in the 1600s, you're going to see the enslavement of Jews in the transatlantic slave trade. It is historically consistent. They were formally expelled from the country in 1306 and had their lands confiscated by the government. I pointed that out before, only to be recalled in 1315 and made to pay for the privilege of returning. Under the rules set in 1315, Jews were ordered not to discuss their religion publicly, made to wear a badge identifying themselves, and cautioned against committing usury, an accusation often leveled at Jews based on racist stereotypes. For a time, the crown was happier to have Jews in its lands paying taxes, but in 1394, Charles VI suddenly demanded they leave once again. France's Jews were given a bit of time to sell their possessions before being escorted out of French lands. There was not a major Jewish population in France again until the 1700s, when Jews fleeing violence and discrimination further east arrived in Alsace and Lorraine. By the eve of the revolution, there were roughly 40,000 Jews in France. Over the course of the turbulent years that followed, 1789, the newly enlightened governments gradually restored Jews' rights to live in France, but they continued to face discrimination and their numbers were further decimated during the Nazi occupation of France. Today, roughly 1% of France is Jewish. So, one more time, let me see, here we go, Iberian Peninsula. You have them kicked out of Spain with the Alhambra Agreement, but before that they were kicked out of France. So they went from France to Spain. Remember, the curses were supposed to follow Israel wherever they go. Go back and read Deuteronomy 28. The curses would follow Israel no matter where they went. They would be chased out of the land, put into slavery, worldwide slavery. So they're chased out of France into Spain, out of Spain into Portugal, out of Portugal into Africa, along the coast, until they end up over here in Sao Tome. They're going to end up all on the west coast of Africa. Judah specifically is going to end up in this area right here. The southern kingdom specifically is going to end up here. And then the slave trade is going to start. Let's keep going. After being banished, let me just start over. It says, how did Portuguese Jews fit into this environment? The history of their presence is part of a forced diaspora from Iberia. After being banished from Spanish lands in 1492, remember, Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492. Now, there are rumors that Columbus was one of these Jews, one of these Spanish or Sephardic Jews that had to flee. That's the rumor. I haven't done enough historical research into it to say, yes, Columbus was one of these guys or not. I'll just say that's the rumor. I've never been too interested in Columbus, to be honest. After being banished from Spanish lands in 1492, Sephardic families in Portugal also became the target of expulsion in 1496 to 1497. That's going to be by King Manuel of Portugal. The 1496 to 1497. Again, King Manuel, I'm not sure if it's the first or the second, but it's King Manuel of Portugal around that time. Some of these numbers and, you know, the order of people start to get confusing once you have a whole lot of history in your head like I do. The alternative was forced conversion to Christianity. This brought into existence a new social category, the so-called New Christians. Henceforth, within the Iberian Catholic world, a social barrier was interposed between the old Christians and the new Christians, all those of Sephardic descent. Now, if you go back to the last video and the video before that, I talked about the new Christians overrunning Sao Tome and Lisbon trying to get a hold, or Portugal trying to get a control over what was going on in Sao Tome. Now, that was our last video from this book right here, The Portuguese in West Africa, 1415 to 1670. Not going to read this whole thing again, but you guys recognize this. New Christians have poisoned the bishop of Sao Tome. It gives an account of new Christians in Sao Tome in the year. This was written in 1632 to Lisbon, a cardinal in Lisbon, and it talks about Sao Tome being overrun with new Christians and Judaism being practiced in the open. And one person said they saw the procession of a golden calf, which is a reference to the Exodus. So we know these are talking about the same people, the new Christians. The new Christians were Jews that converted to Catholicism. All right. So the new Christians are all of Sephardic descent. Now, this is important because, as we've read before, the Spanish Jew is always dark. We've seen them described as black, tawny, and Negro. It says this social distinction was reinforced by the Inquisition or Holy Tribunal. So the Inquisition is reinforcing the distinction. And remember, the Inquisition is spilling over into northern and western Africa. And I said this before and I'll say it again. The transatlantic slave trade was nothing more than an extension of the Inquisition. They are not two separate historical events. They are one in the same. As I pointed out in the last video, in 1834, when England ended slavery, they also ended the Inquisition the same year. All of this stuff is tied together. This social distinction was reinforced by the Inquisition or Holy Tribunal, authorized by the Pope in 1536 after an insistent request from the Portuguese crown, a new step in the long history of persecution of the gentes de Nacaio, people of the Hebrew nation began. One more time, a new step in the long history of the persecution of the gentes de Nacaio, people of the Hebrew nation began. So they started a new step in the long history of persecution towards the Hebrew nation. Once again, I want to show you this map. The Portuguese were putting people down here. Hannah Adams says they were Judah, Levi, and Benjamin, which is the southern kingdom. We know the Portuguese were already enslaving Jews in 1497, thanks to King Manuel of Portugal. And we know that they had already been pushing south into Africa. We know, based on the Iberian Peninsula map, that they had nowhere to go but to Africa because they had already been kicked out of France in the 1300s, Spain and Portugal in the late 1400s, and then they're going to end up down here. All right, so do me a favor, hit that one if you have not hitting this one, hit the one already. If you're enjoying this video, hit the thumbs up button. Make sure you share this video as well. For half a century, historians have debated the religious identity of the new Christians. Among the new Christians, some were faithful Christians and others were public Christians but secret Jews. During the 16th century, the 1500s, the latter group grew distant from the normative Judaism. They were often referred to as crypto-Jews or Marranos. So now we have another name introduced, the Marranos. All right. As recent historiography shows, however, the religious orientations of these groups were flexible. As many as 50,000 Sephardim chose to leave the Iberian Peninsula to find a new life far from the tentacles of the Inquisition in Muslim lands of the Maghreb or the Ottoman Empire, as well as in the new overseas promised lands in sub-Saharan Africa, America, or Asia. After the first diasporic movements at the end of the 15th century, new waves of migration occurred, particularly when the Inquisition intensified its persecution or when new Christians profited from a general authorization to leave Portugal freely. One of the latter moments occurred in the late 16th century and early 17th century, so late 1500s, early 1600s, as hundreds of new Christians left Iberia for the United Provinces, which subsequently became a refuge. There they joined members of the crypto-Jewish communities fleeing the Catholic Spanish occupation of Antwerp and other places. This immigration led to the growth of important Sephardic communities in Rotterdam and especially Amsterdam. We're not going to talk about that yet, but this comes up as well. Jewish communities in Amsterdam, because of the Inquisition. Well, not because of. It grows because of the Inquisition. But we don't want to get sidetracked on that. The connection between Jewish and crypto-Jewish trading networks was steadily strengthened. However, on the geographical margins of empire, where there was no holy tribunal, Sephardim were rarely forced to hide their Jewish identity. In fact, the more peripheral a place, the safer new Christians and Jews tended to feel. West Africa was one such place. Interesting. How is it that Cambridge University, people that attend there or associated with there and write these books, Cambridge looks them over, publishes them, puts their reputation on the line, and they seem to know a lot about Judaism in West Africa. And then we encounter Christians, the racist Christian group, the Urban Apologists, who have been opposed to this information, calling us liars, saying that we fabricated history, we're lying about certain stuff. We see that other people know what's going on. Even Professor Henry Abramson wrote that these people were put down in West Africa and Sao Tome. I'll read this last couple sentences right here again. It says, however, on the geographical margins of empire, where there was no holy tribunal, or AKA the Inquisition, Sephardim were rarely forced to hide their Jewish identity. In fact, the more peripheral a place, the safer new Christians and Jews tended to feel. West Africa was one such place. So now, let's go back over here. So if West Africa was a place that they didn't have to hide their Judaism and they felt safe hiding their Judaism, what happened to Judaism in West Africa? What happened to Judaism in Sao Tome, Angola, and all these other places that Cambridge published authors are referring to? What happened to it? It all disappeared during the transatlantic slave trade. As we talked about in the last video, the names were stripped, family were separated. They had no way to pass on the information or genealogy or history or the original language because they were forced to give up the original language and speak English. They were slaves. They weren't just allowed to practice and keep the Sabbath. They weren't allowed to stick to their dietary customs. They weren't allowed to do this stuff in slavery. Why? Because Judaism had already become illegal. Judaism had been forced out of France, Spain, Portugal, continued to be persecuted in North Africa, West Africa. Now, they were open and freely practicing Judaism. Remember that. West Africa was one place they could open and freely practice Judaism. Let's keep coming back to this. All right. Now I'm going to read through some of this. I'm only going to briefly stop and make references so that way I can get through a good chunk of this. I'm not going to go through all of it, but again, the link will be in the description for this on the Google Books preview and for the full book on Amazon.com. Portuguese, this is page 9. Portuguese archives contain a wealth of documents that are insufficiently utilized by and often unknown to historians of 16th and 17th century West Africa. So 1500s and 1600s. Until recently, relatively few Africanists have recognized the potential significance of the Portuguese archives for Senegambia, a region generally considered within the orbit of Francophone or Anglophone West Africa. Yet, Lusophone sources are crucial for the period of earliest contact between Europeans and West Africans. The late Avelino Teixeira da Mota and Paul Hare were pioneers in publishing, translating, and annotating several important Portuguese primary sources at an international level. Also important are the documents collected and transcribed by Antonio Brasio in the volumes of the Monumenta Missionaria Africana. Nietzsche Isabel de Moraes provides documents and commentary for Francophone scholars. The late Walter Rodney was also one of the first historians to renew our knowledge of the region using Portuguese manuscripts. Jean Boulegue and George Brooks have worked continuously on the history of the region and on Luso-Africans, also making use of Portuguese sources. Now, it's important you guys can run down these names. If you guys are trying to research this topic, run down every single name, run down every single mention, and just keep following it until you can't get any more information. That's basically what I do. Let me see. Contemporary Portuguese scholars such as Maria Amelia Madeira Santos, I'm not going to try to butcher all these names, have made major contributions connecting the history of Guinea to the Cape Verde Islands to the Atlantic routes, followed recently by Tobias Green. Philip Havoc works on gender and together with Tareo, Walter Hawthorne's and Antonio de Almeida Mendez's contributions, these are all notes right here, we'll come down to here, on the slave trade have recently demonstrated the generally undervalued significance of the region to Atlantic history. Interesting how they're over there in Lisbon, Portugal, one of these authors, and they're talking about connecting all of this stuff to the slave trade, the Inquisition to the slave trade, and its shaping of the Atlantic world. These works in our own clearly demonstrate that the Portuguese archives remain a rich source of hitherto unknown documents, some of which will lead to fundamental transformations in our historical knowledge of the 16th and 17th century Upper Guinea Close. The present authors have worked extensively on the history of the Luso-Africans in Senegambia or Guinea of Cape Verde. Mark has investigated, this is still part of the introduction, by the way, I haven't even really gotten to the book, Mark has investigated the construction and evolution of their identity. Horta has focused on their representation in 16th and 17th century Portuguese sources, underlying the nexus of that identity with the Cape Verde Islands. Both writers have argued elsewhere, following Jean Boulegue and Nietzsche Isabella Morales, that among these Luso-Africans, or Portuguese, as they were known in contemporary sources, there were new Christians, a number of whom were practicing Jews. Evidence of the Jewish presence in West Africa remained scanty. However, we initially argued that if some Christian Portuguese were in fact practicing Jews, they were Jews primarily in the privacy of their own homes. Remember, they said that they had argued. What was it? Let me see. We initially argued that if some Christian Portuguese, so they initially argued this, meaning they're probably going to change their stance, but let's keep going. Recent historiography has clarified the role of the Christos Novos, or the New Christians, in the Atlantic Slave Trade Network during the 16th and 17th centuries, and specifically for Guinea, De Cabo Verde. Make sure y'all hit the thumbs up button. Official documents from the Metropole and the island of Santiago are full of accusations that the Junta de Macau were responsible for Portuguese commercial weakness in the region. These references, however, exaggerate the role of New Christians while omitting the role of Cristãos Velhos in a manner that is misleading to the historian. Interesting. If y'all want to support, hit the Cash App, hashtag BHITB. You can hit the Super Chat. PayPal link is in the description. It is important to maintain some distance from the categories used in these early documents, which uniformly conflate Cristãos Novos and Gentes de Nicaio, New Christians, and the people of the nation, while imputing Jewish religious practices to both. Until recently, however, little was known about the implantation of Sephardic practices on the Guinea coast, aside from the fragmentary materials in Father Antonio Brasio's compilation and a few published narratives. This documentation gives the impression, not always clear, that the early 17th century or 1600s, along the Senegalese coast between Cape Verde and Gambia River, the region the French called the La Petite Côte, there were practicing Jews in the, This documentation gives the impression, not always clear, that in the early 17th century or 1600s, along the Senegalese coast between Cape Verde and the Gambia River, the region the French called La Petite Côte, there were practicing Jews living in Rufusque, Porto de Al, and Joal. Portuguese sources invariably assert that these Jews, together with their new Christian allies, traded with French, English, and Dutch merchants. However, neither the precise details of these presumed commercial alliances nor the details of their religious interactions as Jews with local Africans figure in these Portuguese sources. The clarification of this latter issue is crucial to the history of Luso-African identities in Guinea and Cape Verde, which has been a focus of our previous publications. For although Luso-African identity has generally been closely associated with the Christian religion, it is important not to overlook the role that Jewish identity may have played in the creation of Luso-African Portuguese. Now remember, the Luso-Africans were the offspring of the Lankados, according to this. The Lankados were those Jews that had got deported and got to the mainland. Now, I'm not the expert on Luso-Africans, Lankados, Conversos, or any of these people. Shout out again to Brother Benaiah Israel. If y'all got questions on that, I refer you to him. Let's see here. Recently discovered manuscript sources from the Lisbon archives, together with previously known documents that have been reassessed by the authors, occasion a fundamental rethinking of the history of Portuguese New Christians and Jews in Senegambia. Oh, so they're admitting that they may have been wrong. Interesting how people who are actual historians can have an idea, put that out there, and say, you know what, we may have been wrong and correct it. That is not something you will find with many Christians on this topic. Many of them will stick to their lie no matter how much evidence comes out. All you have to do is find the Christians that are opposed to this, start asking them questions about history. If they dodge it, they're a liar. If they won't give you sources, they're lying. If they get upset and start to insult you, they're lying and they're deceiving you. They're trying to manipulate you through their insults. So don't take anything less than historical sources from people who want to talk about history. If they tell you something happened, make them show you the sources. Without sources, it doesn't mean anything. It's just talk. All right, so let's see. Documents from the Lisbon Inquisition preserved in the Portuguese National Archives, Torre de Tombo, as well as other Lisbon archives, provide the foundation for this book. Complementary sources from the Gemeente Archief in Amsterdam, including the notarial archives and documents from the Jewish community, allow us to confirm in detail the commercial activities and later lives of several of these Jews. Together with already published sources, the Lisbon and Amsterdam records clearly demonstrate the presence of traders of Portuguese and Luso-African descent who were also Judas Publicos, practicing Jews who publicly affirmed their Jewish identity on the Petite Cote for three decades beginning circa 1608, aka there was a Jewish presence in Africa prior to the transatlantic slave trade, and they had already begun mixing with the local population, producing more black offspring. Now, I'm going to read one more part, and then I'm going to get ready to close this out. All right, we're going to jump down to page 24, and we're going to read to the top of page 126. It's not that long because most of these are notes that we're not going to read. Like, by almost half this page is notes right here, and I think, yeah, about half this page is notes, and then we'll read this. All right, so we're going to read this, and then I'm going to point to a couple more things, and then I'm going to close out with a Bible verse, some verses from the Bible. In August of 1612, before the official start of the transatlantic slave trade here in America, 1619, information was sent to the Portuguese trading post at Cashew to the vicar of the Rio de São Domingos that new Christians from Flanders were arriving at the Petite Coast on Dutch ships. The men of this second wave had taken Jewish names and they openly practiced Jewish rituals. Significantly, as the term New Christians indicates, these individuals were originally from Portugal. The report asserts, now this is a quote from the report, some men of the nation of New Christians came from the states of Flanders to the coast of Guinea in Flemish ships, and they, having behaved like Christians in this kingdom of Portugal and its overseas territories, have apostatized, some of them taking Jewish names and all of them performing ceremonies and rituals of the law of Moses. Now, remember, this is going on in West Africa. So they've left Portugal, went to Amsterdam. Now they're being brought back to West Africa on the ships. They've taken Jewish names. They're doing Jewish practices. So here's the question. Another common sense question. If all these were white Jews at this time, what happened to them? Where is the records of all these white Jews all over the coast of Africa? Because some people will say, well, these are Jewish people. They're white. So they're mixing with the black people. So you'll have a darker Jews, but they're not black. They're not sub-Saharan black. This is how they distinguish who is who in Christian circles. They base it on how black you are, because you will find that many of them reject the idea that black people could be Israel. What is that based on? Is it based on DNA? Is it based on history? No. It's based on their opinion that black people are in no way connected to these Israelites, because black people were taken from West Africa, so therefore they must be sub-Saharan African. But they leave out the part of the history where they had Jews put down there first. They leave out the part of the history where those Jews were mixing with the local population and having these Jewish or Israelite kids. I'm using the words interchangeably here. They leave out all of that history. They leave out everything Cambridge said about them being targeted, more likely to be seized in wars and sold as slaves. So now we have here, now I want to compare something real quick. All right, so I'm gonna read this one more time. It says, some men of the nation of New Christians came to the states of Flanders to the coast of Guinea in Flemish ships, and they, having behaved like Christians in this kingdom of Portugal and its overseas territories, have apostatized, some of them taking Jewish names and all of them performing ceremonies and rituals of the law of Moses. So on the ships, they immediately converted back. They pretended to be Christians there. And then right here in this letter, it talks about the new Christians. Let me see. In West Africa trading stations, Jewish rites could be practiced with little disturbance from the ecclesiastical authorities. By early 17th century, new Christian influence in West Africa was widespread and flourished alongside other kinds of religious heterodoxy. Mm-hmm. The early 17th century would be the 1600s prior
to the transatlantic slave trade. And this document too, once again, was published by Cambridge University. This was published in 2010. The editor here is Malin Wyatt. Or Newitt, I'm sorry, Malin Newitt. So we have a consistency here. Let me come back up to here. All right. This information, along with similar denunciations 6 months earlier, had to be brought to Kashu by witnesses from Jal and Porto de Ale because there was no official representative of the tribunal, Do Santo Officio, or the Inquisition, on the Petite Coast, nor was there in Kashu. But there, the vicar or vicar could, as a delegate of the Bishop of the Cape Verde Islands, undertake investigations that might eventually lead to prison and shipment of the accused to Lisbon Inquisition. Nevertheless, the absence of a regular tribunal was surely a factor attracting Judaizing new Christians to this region. So, Judaizing. Some of y'all have heard them words, Judaizing. Some of y'all have heard that a lot. Do me a favor, hit the one in the chat if you've heard the word Judaizing in the last 5 years from Christians. Give me a two if you haven't heard them mention Judaizing at all. We've heard them attack people who follow the laws of Moses because apparently to many Christians, Jesus the Son died so that he could omit everything the Father said and obsolete it. You're no longer required by the law to do anything in it. You can disrespect your father and mother. You can go commit adultery. You can do all these things that the Old Testament says don't do according to them. And if I'm lying, ask them why they say the law has been done away with. If you can't do those things, tell me where it says you can't do those things. And they will point directly to the law, the laws of Moses. They will tell you, no, you can't do these things, but also you're not under the law. So you can do these things, but you also can't do these things because you need to be forgiven of your sins. And sin is transgression of the law, but the law has been done away with. So you don't really have a sin to repent from, but you need to repent from the thing that's been done away with. It makes no sense, but hey, let's run with it. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. That's what I'm gonna say. So West Africa was attracting Judaizing new Christians or Jews who had been converted to Catholicism, and now they want to Judaize everybody. I love this stuff. This is interesting, and I'm glad it wasn't written by black people. I'm glad that other people besides us were writing it so that people can't come in and say this is biased. The same sources and an anonymous, unpublished account of foreign trade from the Senegal River to the southern coast, also written in 1612, complained not only that the men from Flanders were living publicly under Jewish law, the Vendo, I'm not going to try to butcher this, is a whole sentence, but also that other Christians were sailing from Portugal to the port of Cashew or to Rio Grande. These new arrivals then traveled to Port de Ale by way of Flanders, according to the anonymous memoria, 1612, some of the new arrivals from Portugal would travel first to Cashew, from there to Port de Ale, and then to Flanders, quite clearly in order to join the Portuguese Jewish community before returning to the Petite Cote, or Petite Cote. The situation of two brothers, Felipe or Felipe de Souza and Diogo Vaz de Souza, is a case in point. Both men, who were originally from Lisbon, settled in Guinea at the Portuguese slave trading post of, I'm guessing that's Santo Domingos or S. Domingos, in what is now northwestern Guinea-Bissau. They then traveled to Amsterdam, where they became Jews, we might say, where they officially converted or reconverted to Judaism. So they didn't necessarily convert. They may have reconverted to Judaism because, remember, they're originally from Portugal. Lisbon, Portugal. Felipe and Diogo then returned to Senegambia. Senegambia, one more time. You got Senegal, and then you got Gambia. They returned to West Africa. Let me see. I'm not going to try to butcher that. In a square-rigged ship, a carack, with many other Portuguese, but all Jews, to settle definitively on the Petite Coast. This is 7 years before the transatlantic slave trade start in America. In the memoria, both Felipe and Diogo are said to have made the above-mentioned circuit, the former passing by Cashew and the latter by the Rio Grande or Grande. Page 26. The genesis of this movement is not clear. It appears to have been inspired by contact with Portuguese Jews who came to the Petite Coast with the first ships from the United Provinces, but it may have begun with a local Sephardic network that maintained contact along the Upper Guinea Coast. It is highly probable that the arrival of these Jews at the Petite Coast was inspired by contact with earlier settlers, Portuguese New Christians who had settled on the Senegalese coast as Lancados during the 16th century. One settler, Luis Fernandez Duarte, alias Joshua Israel, had learned from his brother Manuel de Fonesco and from Diogo Nunes de Fonesco, maybe also a close relative, about their own business connections with D. Sebastio, the papal king of Bussis. In a letter to the king, Louis asserted that his relatives considered themselves brothers of Sebastio. Hence, a kind of inheritance of clients based in family links facilitated trade for new arrivals. The commercial success of these earlier traders, some of whom subsequently returned to Portugal, and the fact that on the Petite Coast they were not bothered by agents of the Inquisition surely played a role in the decision of the Portuguese immigrants to Amsterdam in the early 17th century to travel to Joal and Porto de Ale. The Petite Coast was a part of Senegambia about which they had up-to-date information and where they could safely practice the Jewish religion. What happened to all of them? Where did all of these openly practicing Jews in West Africa go? Why is it that when we hear about slavery, we were swinging on trees with bones in our noses, we were Muslims, we were everything except for Israelites and New Christians? Everything except for Jews and New Christians. Those are the only things that are not associated with us. Why? Because that's associated with the Inquisition. And see, if you go back to the Inquisition, you can't say the Portuguese didn't know who the Jews were because they kicked them out. You can't say the Spanish didn't know who the Jews were because they kicked them out. You can't say the French didn't know who the Jews were because they kicked them out. So the French, the Spanish, and the Portuguese all knew who the Jews were. Now, if you come over here to the Kingdom of Witta or Judah Mapping Project on blackhistoryinthebible.com, a link will be in the description. You will see the maps from all these people who knew. You'll see the maps from all these people who knew. Remember I said France. This is a French map right here. You guys can actually buy this map, print it out, $345 if you want to buy it. This is Barry Lawrence. They sell antique maps. As you can see right there, they marked Judah on the map. Now, remember, they know who the Jews are. They kicked the Jews out of France. It's a French map. Paris, 1707. This right here is a Spanish map from the Harvard University, Harvard map collection. What do you see right here? You see Judah, Ardra and Judah. Those are going to come up together a lot. But you see Judah right here. They knew who this was. The English knew who this was. This is the English map right here, Judah. They all knew where Judah was because they had been kicking the Jews out of their countries and chasing them down into Africa. Once again, France kicked them out. Spain kicked them out. Portugal kicked them out. They end up in North Africa and West Africa. And then they end up in Sao Tome. They end up in Angola. What did the Portuguese do? Establish places in Angola to encourage the slave trade. They named the Kingdom of Judah the Slave Coast. They started enslaving all up and down West Africa. All right, so I'm gonna finish this up right. I'm gonna read this last paragraph and this part right here, and then we'll wrap it up. Actually, no, right to here. So we're gonna go to page 28, and then I'm gonna read two more things, and then we're gonna wrap this up. All right. By the early 1600s, the arrival of Portuguese New Christians in the port cities of Northern Europe and their return to their ancestral religion led to the growth of significant Sephardic communities in Amsterdam, Hamburg, and to a lesser degree, Rotterdam. Most of the earliest members of Amsterdam's newly founded Sephardic community had come from Portugal, and they maintained close commercial connections to their family members back in Lisbon. This contact often passed through Antwerp, which remained part of the Spanish possessions after the northern provinces of the Netherlands had established their effective independence. All right, for context, I've been talking a lot about Amsterdam and the Netherlands. Now, here's the Iberian Peninsula. This is Spain. This is Portugal. Here you have Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia. So this is North Africa. Up in here, here's Egypt, the Sinai Peninsula. Over here, you're going to have Israel. And up here is where you have the Netherlands. And Amsterdam is going to be located in the Netherlands. So when they were kicked out of here, some fled around this way, avoiding France. Because remember, Spain, France, they fled around this way, avoided France, came to the Netherlands, and then they would come back around to the west coast of Africa. This is what we just read. So here to here and here to here. And then sometimes they would go from here to here and then back. So they were avoiding all of this, going around it, because they were already kicked out of here. And England participated too in past date, but we're not going to get sidetracked getting into England right now. All right. Most of the earliest members of Amsterdam's newly Sephardic community had come from Portugal, and they maintained close commercial connections to their family members back in Lisbon. This contact often passed through Antwerp, which remained part of the Spanish possessions after the northern provinces of the Netherlands had established their effective independence. By 1608 or 1609, the Dutch Jews, or those from Amsterdam, were outfitting trading vessels that sailed to the Petite Cote on an annual basis or over into West Africa. These voyages were financed largely by Sephardic merchants. Interesting, because you will hear this topic of Jews owning slave ships coming up in different conversations. Some people will say the Ashkenazi owned slave ships, but some of these may not have been slave ships, and they may not have all been Ashkenazi. Some Sephardic may have owned transport or merchant vessels, and some of them may have financed the smuggling of Jews from the Netherlands into West Africa where they could openly practice. Again, I'm saying may have, because a lot of history, we think it's one thing until we start to read deeper and then we find out, hey, maybe that's not the case. Maybe it's different than we thought it was, because we only learned partial information in school, high school, college, whatever. And it may not have been the whole thing. All right. By 1608 or 1609, the Dutch Jews were outfitting trading vessels that sailed to the Petite Coast on an annual basis. These voyages were financed largely by Sephardic merchants. The ships traded at the ports of Porto de El and Jawal. By 1611, some of these vessels, also called at a third trading community, were there, where there were Sephardic traders, Recife church authorities were never able to impose their jurisdiction over the Petite Cote, and the 1612 investigation did not lead to any trials. The survival of the Jewish communities was never effectively challenged. The Jesuit father Sebastio Gomez wrote from Santiago in the Cape Verde Islands, because in several parts of the mainland, Guinea, they're talking about over here in West Africa. Get back to the other one. Particularly the one which is called the coast, i.e. the coast of Porto de El and Joal, there are many Portuguese who declare themselves as Jews. And because several heretics of different sects come to this place with whom one could have continuous disputes on matters of faith. So the Portuguese are calling themselves Jews in West Africa. What happened to all of those Jews in West Africa? Because everything I've read to you is up until 1612. This is prior to the 1619 date that America gives as the beginning of the transatlantic slave trade. And if you don't know why they give that date, please go back, watch the previous video, and I talk about H.R. 1242. Right here, H.R. 1242, 400 Years African American History Commission Act, right here, Point Comfort, Virginia, 1619. This is where they count from. So if you don't know why they are using the date 1619 or why we say that, here is why. It's recognized by Congress. The 115th Congress recognized this as the date. So you can point to this and say, well, this is why we use 1619, because America, the Congress recognizes 1619 as the official start here in America. Now, when we say that date 1619, we're not talking about everywhere else, because we know they went into South America first. America is important for a different reason, but not going to get sidetracked into that. It says an anonymous author replied that the fourth reason required more action and fire from the Inquisition than the doctrine of the gospel spread by unarmed and poor preachers. For the Jewish merchants who settled on the Petite Côte, their resulting situation was highly desirable. Unlike the new Christians and Moranos, forcibly converted Jews who continued secretly to practice Judaism in Brazil and New Spain, studied by Nathan Watchell, almost none, and perhaps not a single one, of the Jews of Joal and Porta de El became victims of the Inquisition. Even 20 years later, the religious situation on the Petite Côte does not seem to have undergone significant change. All right, so now we've established that the Portuguese put Jews in West Africa, all over West Africa. We've established that these Jews then started to mix with the local population and produce, they were called Lancados because they got off of the islands and onto the mainland. Then the children of these Lancados were the Luso Africans, and they also mixed in with the local population because that's what they do. And so over time, what would happen? Remember, 200 years of this. Over time, what would happen? They would gradually be the same color or become darker, assuming that they were light to begin with, which we would be wrong in assuming. Because if we come over here to the Grand Gazetteer or Topographic Dictionary, etc., written by Andrew Bryce in 1760, it was published in 1760, falls under category geography, 1446 pages. It's definitely grand. On page 622 of this document right here, this is hard to read. I will leave the links for you guys. But right here in this section, I went ahead and typed it out on blackhistoryinthebible.com so it'd be easier to read. And so right here, Jesvez, see, I took a screenshot of it so you can see where it is. The link, if you want to click the link right here, link Google Books, originals from Harvard University, author Andrew Bryce, 1760. And page 622, it says the river and village in Negro land. Hold on real quick. Negro land right there. Negro land, Judah, slave coast. You see, it's all connected. All right. All right. Let's come back down to here. The river and village in Negro land. The river lies to the north and northeast of Basu Isle. The village, 65 leagues above its mouth to east and 40 FR, not sure what that means, Basu to the south, and the river running almost east and west. The people inhabiting the banks are partly Biafras and idolaters, partly Mandingos and Mohammedans. The Portuguese have a factory on the banks. You see it right here. The Portuguese have a factory on the banks. The village contains near 4,000 inhabitants, among whom not above 10 or 12 families of whites. The rest are all tawny or black, though they style themselves true Portuguese. So, if you assumed that these were all white Jews that were deported, they're telling you right now, again, this was published in 1760. It's saying that there were only 10 to 12 families of whites right here. The rest all tawny or black, though they style themselves true Portuguese. So these were not white Portuguese Jews. These were black Portuguese Jews that were taken from or kicked out of Spain and Portugal, France first, then Spain, then Portugal, put into West Africa, fled into North Africa. They were black. Because all this activity we read about, I read about for a reason. There's no way all that activity is for 10 or 12 families of white Jews. We know this is not true. This says it's 4,000 inhabitants, nearly 4,000 inhabitants, of which only 10 to 12 families are white. Everything we read about could not have possibly been about white Jews. But let's go to another source. Read this before. This is image 45 from a mission to Galele, King of the Homi. This is image 45 from the Library of Congress, volume 1. I have a link here. Right here, the title, Mission to Galele, King of Dahomey, with notices of the so-called Amazons, the Grand Customs, the Yearly Customs, the Human Sacrifices, the Present State of the Slave Trade, and the Negro's Place in Nature, written by Sir Richard Francis Burton, 1812 to 1829. So this was published in 1864. So the last one I read you was published in 1760. This is 1864, roughly 100 years later. The last source says that they were tawny or black Portuguese and only 10 to 12 families of whites. You can't make it any more clear than that, because sometimes people will play the color game and say, well, there were Jews, but they weren't black Jews. The black Jews were converts. Well, here we have it very clearly pointed out. 4,000 people, 10 to 12 families of whites, the rest were black. It's starting to look like the whites were the converts and not the other way around. So right here, after 2 years of constant quarreling, right here, you can read that. That's part of the actual text. But down here in the notes, it says, some of the kidnapping tales that still linger on this coast show the straits into which, at times, men were driven for cargo at Annobon. Now, right here is a map. Annobon, or Annobom, as is written over there, but here's a map where it is. You can see it's off the coast of Africa. So once again, some of the kidnapping tales that still linger on this coast show the straits into which at times men were driven for a cargo at Annobom, where the people are Negro Portuguese. That lines up exactly what we're saying. What was being said in 1760, 4,000 inhabitants, among whom not above 10 or 12 families of whites, the rest all tawny or black, though they style themselves Portuguese. That's from 1760 here, Library of Congress, 1864, 1 year before the abolition of slavery. If anybody's telling you this stuff is biased, they need to explain how. Where the people are Negro Portuguese, they are ever looking forward to hearing mass from the mouth of a priest. They were likely new Christians. Likely. A Spaniard, learning this, dressed up a pair of ecclesiastics, landed them, and whilst the function was proceeding, seized the whole congregation and carried them triumphantly to market. What market? The slave markets. This goes into a whole bunch of other stuff, but yes, they were kidnapping Negro Portuguese and putting them into the transatlantic slave trade. Now, this is going to bring us back over to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge right here. And I'm just going to read this part because you guys can go through and read this yourself. Link will be in the description. I'll read it down to here. Once again, in southern Nigeria, the natives called Black Jews the strange people in the Imo-Yokwaim. They are called the Bani Ephraim, the sons of Ephraim. They claim that their ancestors came from Morocco. One more time, Morocco's here. Why? Because they fled out of Portugal into Morocco. So now they're talking about in Nigeria, they're claiming that their ancestors came from Morocco. So North Africa down into West Africa. This is completely consistent history when you're not lying about who people are and where they went. They claim that their ancestors came from Morocco, and this is supported by Gabi, who noted that their language is a mixture of Maghrebian Arab, ancient Hebrew, and local Patois. For example, Abu meaning father became Yaba. For mother is close to the Hebrew word. These Imo-Yokwaim Jews live in the Ondo district and have a copy of the Torah. The studies of customs and rites and the analysis of the semantics, that means their language, I'm not the language guy, Again, shout out to Dr. Pastor or Pastor Kelly. The study of customs and rights and the analysis of the semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to propose some hypothesis and even to draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godbey reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. I'm gonna pause right now. What happened to all these Negroes that were Jews in West Africa during the slave trade and before the slave trade? Where did they go? This is a common sense question. Where did they disappear to? Because I've told y'all before, when you study certain people's history, there's always a convenient disappearance of people and nobody knows where they went. Common sense tells us that the Inquisition chased them down there. And the Inquisition involved Portugal and Spain. And we're seeing reports of the Portuguese and Spanish enslaving the people in the same areas where they went. Then clearly these people didn't disappear. They were the victims of the slave trade because they were already being enslaved. But let's keep going. Remember, Cambridge University published this one too, as well as the other two documents I've showed you. The study of customs and rights and semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to propose the same hypothesis and even draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godbey reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that point? To the extent that they were persecuted. Why were they persecuted? Because of the Inquisition. The Portuguese didn't just go down and start persecuting African Jews. They sent Jews down there and continued to persecute them and their Luso-African descendants, as we just read. So, to the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes, who were those? The Luso-Africans. So it is virtually certain that Luso-Africans, part Jewish Negroes, whatever you want to call them, they're full Israelites, because if you're the son of an Israelite or the daughter of an Israelite, that makes you an Israelite. You're not a part Israelite. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves, not hitchhiked aboard the ships, not caught rides or whatever, you know, the other dude wanted to say. Y'all know who I'm talking about. And if you don't, he's not important anyway. Virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How many of them would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. This conclusion put forward by Godbey, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken. The same places where Judaism was recurrent in the same places in which the Negroes were taken. Which is going to bring us back to the new and accurate map of Africa, where you have Judah, slave coast. So how is it that you put Jews down here? They're on the West Coast. They're all over the West Coast. You have a kingdom of Judah. They claim to be Judah, Levi, and Benjamin. They mark the area as the slave coast. And then people will say, you guys have nothing to do with the Jews, the Inquisition, the Israelites of the Bible. None of that stuff. It's all coincidence. All coincidence, long series of coincidences, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse. Let me just read that sentence again. This conclusion put forward by Godbey, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse, but most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated Black Americans as a key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. Brought in slavery to the American continent. Interesting. Interesting that all of this seems to point to what happened, what's being described in Joel 3 and other parts of the Bible. Deuteronomy 28, if you have not read it,
please read it. I'm going to read Joel chapter 3 because it's interesting. If you never read the book of Revelation, please read the book of Revelation. Joel 3 offers an explanation to the book of Revelation. If you don't understand why the events in the book of Revelation are occurring, you need to understand the Old Testament. Unfortunately, in many Christian churches, the Old Testament is just kind of swept to the side, except for when they need to cherry pick verses. There's not a focus on it. But the book of Revelation is a culmination of the events in the Old Testament described as the day of the Lord. Now, if you're not familiar with the Old Testament, the book of Revelation seems to come out of nowhere in the context of the New Testament. It talks about forgiveness and grace and salvation through Christ. But then all of a sudden, when you hit the last book, you see Christ return in judgment. People who would not repent, people who were breaking God's law, idolaters and all kind of other stuff it lists. Mm-hmm. So you're sitting there reading it and you're like, wait a minute. I thought the New Testament was about forgiveness. And yet we're seeing judgment, but they're being judged on things that I'm finding in the Old Testament. So if you don't understand Revelation, please read the Old Testament, specifically focus on the day of the Lord and read through the book of Revelation and compare it with the things you see in the Old Testament. I'm going to do some of that now. I'm not going to read this whole chapter. I'm going to read the first 17 verses, but I'm going to point out some things and the reason the book of Revelation is necessary. Now, remember, in Deuteronomy 28, there was a list of things that God would do if Israel did not obey and a list of things he would do if they did. He also, later on in Deuteronomy 29, they accept the covenant. Deuteronomy 30, he promises to restore the covenant if they repent. So in Joel 3, he's given a reason for the explanations of the book or the events in Revelation. It says, for behold, in those days and in that time, so this is future, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations, not some, not a few, all nations, and will gather them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Who was doing this? Who scattered Israel and parted the land? It was Europeans. Started with the Romans. 70 AD, it didn't really start with them, but the Romans in 70 AD in more recent history. And then you get France in the 1300s, you get Spain in the 1400s, Portugal in the 1400s, you get the transatlantic slave trade starting in the 1500s and carrying along into the 1800s. A vast scattering of people, the biggest scattering of people in history. So they parted his land. Look into who parts the land of Israel. If you believe that's the land of Israel, what we're talking about. We also know that it does not encompass everything that was promised in the Bible. It was from the Nile to the Euphrates. Read Genesis 15 if you don't know what lands were promised. And they have cast lots for my people and have given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. So they're using his people as money. If we come back over here to Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, page 230. The Negro was common money. A promissory note which could be counted on, a bill of exchange which discharged a debt of nature. Human flesh was the standard of merchant values. The standard negotiation was the Peace of India, which meant a Negro who conformed to calibrated physical criteria. How many Negroes were sold in this way? Quinnell, in his thesis on the black slave trade, estimates a total of some 80 million, but it could be argued that some 100 million men and women were torn from Africa from the 15th century or the 1400s onwards. In North America, only the southern states had a climate the blacks could survive, and the southern planters employed them in such massive numbers that at the time of the War of Independence, the population of the most prosperous regions of the United States were half black. So they were using them as money. Interesting. They've cast lots for my people. They've given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. Interesting. They're being used as money in the same places these Jews were sent. I'm just pointing out the coincidences of history and biblical prophecy. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon and all the coast of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if you recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return the recompense upon your own head? Now, remember, go back to the last video. I pointed out that they didn't want the Jew or the people in church praying too loud for the Jews because they didn't want God to hear what they were doing.
It's interesting how all this stuff comes up. And now they're talking about recompense or reparation. Are you going to pay reparations? I'll return it on your head. It says, because ye have taken my silver and gold and have carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things, the children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have ye sold unto the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Interesting. Selling the children of Judah? Far from their border, huh? Far from their border. Let me see. What map should I pull up? Let's just pull to Morocco. You have Africa here. Let me pull this one up. You have the Americas over here. So if you believe Israel is over here, 70 AD, they're forced out of Israel, so they scatter. Some of them went into the Caucasus and stuff. We talked about that. The ones that were over here, once the Inquisition started, the expulsions from France and everywhere else, they ended up here, all around here in West Africa, all up in through here. Some of them said they migrated from Morocco down into Nigeria. And then once they get there, they're put into the transatlantic slave trade and they're forced all over here. And then you'll see some show up in Asia. So the transatlantic slave trade distributes them here, all in here, all up and around here. We already saw that they were already traveling around here. So they are literally being dispersed worldwide at that point. They're being removed far from their border. Behold, I will raise them out of the place whither ye have sold them, and will return your recompense on your own head. It's literally talking about slavery. There's no denying this. And I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hands of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them to the Sabians, to a people far off, for the Lord hath spoken it. I'm going to keep going back to this. Judah, the slave coast. Proclaim ye this among the Gentiles. And for those of you who've been following me, I do not believe the Gentiles are the northern kingdom. We'll talk about it at a different time, but go watch my Gentiles videos. I do believe they are the descendants of Japheth. I don't believe the Bible suddenly becomes inconsistent in the New Testament. And again, go watch my videos on that for more of a breakdown. Prepare war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords. Plowshares are used for gardening. He's saying turn these into weapons. And your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. God is declaring war on the Gentiles. Again, read the book of Revelation if you want the full context. Assemble yourselves and come, all ye heathen, and gather yourselves together round about. Thither cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be awakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about. Put ye in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full, the fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision, for the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. As I mentioned, the day of the Lord is important. You'll see this in Revelation. You'll see this in the Olivet Discourse right here. The sun and the moon shall be darkened and the stars shall withdraw their shining. That appears throughout the Old Testament. It appears in the Olivet Discourse that Christ gave, and it appears in the book of Revelation with the sixth seal. The Lord also shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem, and the heavens and the earth shall shake. But the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. For people to say Israel's done away with, they're lying to you. If they say Israel's not important no more, they're lying to you. This would mean that either they're lying or God is lying in the Bible. And I'm putting my bets on God telling the truth. God did not say all this was obsolete because Christ came and died. He's telling you what's going to happen in the future. Now, if he said this knowing full well that he was going to send Christ to die for all of mankind, that would mean that he really didn't know the future and he was just telling people something that wasn't ever going to happen. And he's saying it as if it was going to happen. But we know this has not happened yet. So either the people telling you that Israel no longer matters are lying, or the Bible is lying. Take your pick. It's up to you. Do me a favor. Hit the thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. So shall ye know that I am the Lord your God dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall be no strangers. There shall no strangers pass through her anymore. So do me a favor. hit the one if you've enjoyed this study. Make sure you subscribe if you have not already subscribed. I got a lot more stuff for you guys coming. I've been coming across sources. Shout out to the people who send me sources on a regular basis. I have not been able to get through them all. But there are more sources coming. Again, make sure you share this video on your social media if you've not already done so. The small clips will be coming out in the next few days. I'll be chopping this video up, making it more shareable for those that are interested. If you want to become a supporter of the channel, you can do so with Cash App, #BHITB. The PayPal link is in the description. You can also join the channel as a member, or you can go to patreon.com/BHITB and become an ongoing patron. So, until next time, with that said, I'm out.